Good morning and welcome to Lake Ozark Christian Church. This is a recorded sermon for Sunday, June the 7th. For those of you who are not able to attend or have the desire not to attend because of health reasons, we want you to know that we care about you, we love you, and we're here to serve you. So let's begin our worship together this morning with a word of prayer. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we ask you that your presence be made known to us in a special way in this day. May your name be praised from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. We ask you this morning by your Holy Spirit to breathe on us and bind us together in Christian love and servanthood. And Lord God, may you transform our lives and the lives of those in our community into the image of Jesus Christ, in whose name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Now today,
there is a name I love to hear, I love to sing its words. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh,
will be the first Sunday that we'll have in-person worship service here at the church. It'll be an 8:15 early morning service outside, and we'll continue to do that weather permitting. And then also at our usual 10:30 service, we'll be here in the sanctuary. It'll be a little different because we have some pews roped off to maintain social distancing. We're inside, we're going to be asking people to wear a mask outside. It'll be up to you whether you want to do that. But listen to me, friends. No matter what, you have to take personal responsibility for what you believe is in your best interest health-wise and for the interest of those around you. If you're not feeling well, please stay home. If you feel anxious about being around other people, please stay home. It doesn't mean that we don't love you. Just the opposite. We want you to feel loved in return. And so we're here to serve you this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? And let's pray for those who are not able to be here but are watching on video. We pray that you would feel loved by God, by us. We pray that your needs are being met. And by the way, if they're not, please don't hesitate to call. We also pray for all of our first responders who, during this horrific time of not only a pandemic, but also the riots that are taking place throughout our country. We pray for our country that God would bring peace, but also justice. And we're going to take a moment so that you can lift up your own prayer concern to God and pray silently together, and then I'll lead us in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, maker of heaven and earth, with joy we give thanks for all of your goodness to us. We praise you for the love which has created and sustained us to this day, and for the gift of Christ who brings us into covenant with you and with all your people of faith. Help us to treasure your gifts, Lord God, and help us to show thankfulness by the way in which we live our lives and give ourselves to your service. We pray for your church today, Lord. We pray that you would give it pastors, especially here at Lake Ozark, as we continue this search for a new installed minister. We ask that you would send a pastor that's full of the Spirit and has strength to serve and listens for guidance from you and through your word. And we pray that you would unite your people into that one holy church, that we might bear witness to you and to your glory. Oh God, we pray that you would be with our country, with our leaders, whether they be national leaders or local leaders. It's hard to be a leader in this time. We ask you to give them strength as well. Give them the knowledge and wisdom in order to carry out those things that need to be done in order to protect all of our citizenry. We ask you to comfort those who are sorrowful today, those who are in need, those who are sick or facing adversity. Have mercy on those to whom death draws near, Lord God, and bring consolation to those in mourning, and give your peace, the peace that the world can't give and the world can't take away. For these things we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. This morning I'm going to be speaking from the Gospel of Matthew, the very last paragraph in that book, chapter 28, verses 16 through 20, where these words appear. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw them, when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. You know, after John 3:16, this passage in Matthew might well be the second best known passage in the entire New Testament. It's been aptly named the Great Commission in that it outlines this clear plan of spreading the faith. And it's used by churches of all denominations, by the way. Yeah, you see it everywhere. Matthew 28, the Great Commission. It's used by churches of all theological leanings, conservative, liberal, and it appears in churches that I've served everywhere in the Constitution bylaws is referred to as a statement of purpose. Why do you exist? To make disciples. Go therefore and make disciples, yes. It's interesting to me that this one passage of scripture has such significance attached to it by people of all theological stripes, yeah. And it's used to sum up their entire reason for existing. That's a lot of weight to put on one passage of scripture, and yet this scripture is written so well, it's able to do just that, carry that weight. So we want to look at it this morning in depth and to see how it speaks to us today right here in Lake Ozark Christian Church. The passage begins by telling us that it was 11 disciples who went to the mountain as Jesus had directed. Matthew drawing attention now to the fact that Judas wasn't there. Judas wasn't there because Judas was dead. After seeing the crucifixion of Jesus and knowing his part in the betrayal, he was so taken by remorse that he committed suicide, hung himself. Yeah, that's a pretty stiff reminder of the cost of making a bad decision, friends. But I think it's more than just that. It's also a way of approaching this whole topic of authority. Because authority was the battleground between Jesus and the religious leaders of Israel. They were constantly questioning Jesus. Who gave you your authority? They were jealous because of the crowds that followed Jesus. And they were threatened because they saw these crowds were moving away from them as a source of authority, moving towards Jesus. Because he spoke as someone who had authority. They had Jesus crucified because he was a threat to their authority. With Jesus dead, they thought, well, things would go back to normal and they would be reestablished in their own authority. It didn't work out that way, though. The 11, that is the 12 disciples minus Judas, the 11 went to Galilee, and there on a mountaintop, they met with Jesus. Now, the fact that they're meeting on a mountaintop is significant in and of itself. Because in Matthew's gospel, mountaintops are places of revelation and disclosure. In chapter 5, it was on a mountaintop that Jesus gave his famous sermon. We call it the Sermon on the Mount. And in it, he laid out the way in which righteous people are to live. In chapter 17, it was on the mountaintop that Jesus himself was transfigured. And God spoke and said, "This is my son in whom I am well pleased." And now here we are at the closing of the gospel. And here's, once again, the disciples and Jesus on a mountaintop. Mountaintop. And you know, Jesus appeared to them on that mountaintop, and what they did was they worshiped him. Well, you know, I would too. I would too. If I was there, and so would you. I mean, what a wonderful thing that would be to go to the mountaintop and have Jesus appear to you there. We'd all bow a knee. We'd all worship him. You know, throughout the history of Israel, though, the Israelites were taught that God was one and that they were to worship no other gods before him. And now here are these disciples giving worship to Jesus, and so we're seeing a theological statement being made here by this worshiping of Jesus. On this mountaintop, everything's changed. Jesus, who was crucified, who died and was buried, is now alive, and he's standing right there in front of them. The disciples are struck with awe at the sight of him, and so they do the only thing that they know how to do, and that's to worship him. Yes. And then comes this peculiar comment. But some doubt it. Some doubt it. Interesting, isn't it? Mm-hmm. That some of the 11, that inner circle of Jesus, those people who had been with him for 3 years or more, who ate with him and slept with him and watched as he was crucified, and now here they're on this mountaintop, they're worshiping. But some are doubting. Some are doubting. We're not told why they doubted, but just that they did. And that ought to be a source of encouragement to all of us, my friends, because if you're like me, I often find myself doubting. Doesn't mean that I don't love God or that I don't love Jesus. Not at all. It doesn't mean that I don't trust God. Of course I trust God. It simply means that I'm not always 100% sure of the way I'm interpreting what's going on right in front of me. I'm just one of those people that has to analyze things from every different perspective. To me, this isn't a lack of faith, friends. In fact, it seems to me that it takes more faith to push ahead in the face of doubt than it does in the absence of it. Notice that Jesus here doesn't address the doubt at all. Instead, he makes this pronouncement. All authority, he says, has been given to me. All authority. And in making that statement, Jesus was doing more than affirming that worship of those disciples. He was informing them of the universality of his authority. He wasn't just Lord of this mountaintop, or even Israel, or even just the Lord of heaven. He is one who has all authority, all authority. His authority is universal. It extends to all of heaven and throughout the entire earth. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the Almighty God. And at his name, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And therefore, we worship him, whether we doubt or not, doesn't matter, because he is Lord and he's worthy to be praised. Jesus then went on to give these disciples their marching orders. Here's what he said. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I commanded you. You know what Jesus was sending forth these disciples? With this word, go, go. This is something that they had to do. They had a choice. They could sit there or they could obey and go. It's something that I believe that Matthew included here in this gospel to remind us that the church in every place and in every age is called to go, go. Yeah. But it's more than just a simple message to go. It's to go therefore, therefore. It's an order to go in the authority of the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior. All authority, he said, has been given to me. Now you go and you carry out the work that I've been doing. That's what Christianity is all about, my friends. And then Jesus laid out this plan. Go, therefore, and make disciples. Now making disciples is a far cry from what has now come to pass as evangelism. In our time, it doesn't mean much, does it? Nowadays, we're more interested in how many people are sitting in your pews than we are in making disciples. We're so desperate to get people to like us that we lower the requirements. We don't tell people what's expected of them because we're afraid they won't like us anymore. Yeah. I remember when I was in high school thinking about going into the military. And the recruiter painted this really rosy picture for me. It sounded like I was signing up for a nice vacation more than it was going into the Army. But when I got to basic training, it was a whole different ballgame. And I noticed that all during basic training, we weren't called soldiers. No, we were called recruits. As a reminder, we weren't worthy of the title soldier. We had some training to do first, and we had to pass a test. And it's the same way in the church, my friends. People have to be trained in order to carry out the work of the church. Yeah. That's what Jesus was telling his disciples here. Go make disciples, disciples. Well, how do you do that? Well, Jesus outlined a two-step process here. He said, first, you baptize them, and then you teach them. And he began with baptism because baptism is the initiation into this Christian way of life. And here's why. To be baptized, the candidate must first make a profession of faith. And for that to happen, someone had to tell them the story of who Jesus is and what he's done for them. And that would be us, friends, the church. As people of faith, people who have experienced the love of Christ in their own lives, it's our job then to help others experience that love too. It's only in this way that people are able to come to faith and give their lives to him. It's only in this way that they come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. The second step Jesus told them is to teach them to obey everything that I've commanded you. You know, giving your life to Christ and being baptized is step one. Learning to live for Christ is step two. And that makes sense, doesn't it? Yet somehow we've come to believe that people don't really need to be taught these things because somehow or another they're supposed to already know them. Now, I don't know how that works. Maybe osmosis, sit on a pew and somehow or another all this goes into your brain. I don't think so. I don't know why I had to go to school all these years. If all I had to do was sit in the pew. Think about it for a minute. Think about it. Do we really believe that? No, we don't. No. I think we make these assumptions because it's easy. Easy. We don't like it when people tell us how to live, and we're uncomfortable with telling other people how they're supposed to live, but that misses the point. My experience is that living for Christ doesn't come natural. If anything, it's very unnatural. Just read the Gospels and you'll see how his teachings offended most of the people because they ran counter to everything they had been taught. It's still true to this day. That's why we have been given this mandate to teach people to obey the teachings of Christ. Yeah. We're supposed to present to the world an alternative way of living on this earth. We're to demonstrate that way of life through our own discipleship in obeying God and loving one another. Now, you know, that might sound simple, but we all know how very difficult that can be. It's so difficult that it often requires us to lay down our life for the sake of others. This is what Jesus did for us, and it's what he is asking us to do. The text ends with Jesus giving his disciples this great promise, and remember, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. I'm most thankful for this great commission that it ends with these words. They're a great comfort to me because they remind me that I'm not in this alone, and neither are you, friends. No one's asking you to do anything alone. Jesus said, I am with you always. Forever, even to the end of the age. Jesus is right here, right now, right where you are. He's as close as the mentioning of his name. I think too often we forget this most important point. We're too quick to rely on our own resources, too ready to listen to experts, too anxious to copy what everybody else is doing, and we forget that the church is under the authority and the care of Jesus Christ. It's his church. He's the commander in chief. He's the CEO, if you will. He's the boss. And by the way, he's a very good boss. He's the kind of boss that not only makes demands, but also makes sure that you have everything you need in order to carry them out. Yeah. And remember, he told his disciples, remember, I'm always with you, always. If you need anything at all you have to do is ask. I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. That means that he's still with us today, friends. He's here right now, wherever you are. He's here. Yep. And he's here to give us, each one of us, exactly what we need in order to carry out the mission of the church, in order that we might experience the joy of serving him. He's called us to be disciples, to carry on his work here on earth, so that others might come to know him and have their lives transformed as well. This is the word of God for the church today. My friends, in this time of pandemic, in this time of civil unrest, of looting and watching our cities burn the injustices that are taking place, Lord, we need an injection of that love of Christ in our lives in order that we might share it with others. Share it with others and bring them to that saving grace of Jesus Christ. Why don't you take a knee today and worship Him? Doesn't matter if you doubt. Doesn't matter. Take a knee. Or if you can't kneel, do whatever you need to do, but pray and ask Christ to come into your life afresh and anew and reveal to you how close He is to you and how much He loves you and how much He's given to you to carry out His work here on earth. In fact, let me help you. Let's pray right now. Lord God, we do lift our voices in prayer this morning, asking You to forgive us of our sins. Forgive us, Lord God, of our lethargy and our apathy, for looking for an easy way in everything that we do, especially here in church. Help us, Lord God, to obey You, to become disciplined and therefore disciples, in order that we might enjoy all the benefits that You have for us. Pour out Your Spirit upon us, Lord God, and do with power from on high, in order that we might carry out the work of Your church. And these things we ask in Your holy and precious name. Amen. Amen. Stay healthy. Stay in prayer. Amen.